Hey, Lauren here. Let's talk about Lindsay Ellis quitting YouTube and just in general, reaping what she hath sown. So Lindsay Ellis is one of those old school content creators who has been on YouTube for a long time. In fact, I think she's been making videos for over a decade at this point. And she has been very influential in what she does. And I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that she has helped shape critical media video essays as a genre into what they are currently online. She's been hugely successful at what she does. She's gained millions of subscribers and thousands of Patreon supporters, and she's even leveraged her massive online audience into becoming a best-selling author. But something else about Lindsay Ellis, and one of the reasons why I'm not a fan of hers, despite acknowledging that she is clearly very thoughtful and very intelligent, is that most of her media criticism does come from a progressive, left-wing, intersectionalist viewpoint, seeing as how Lindsay Ellis is a progressive, left-wing, intersectionalist. And I just want to say there's nothing wrong with that, even though I personally don't agree with that perspective. That doesn't mean that I don't wish Lindsay Ellis all the success in the world. But the problem with making content that caters to a progressive, left-wing, intersectionalist viewpoint is that, more likely than not, you will in fact cultivate an audience that also shares progressive, left-wing, intersectionalist opinions. And I think we are far enough along in the culture war that most of us realize by now that, yeah, that is frankly an inherently toxic audience to cater to. And essentially, the too long didn't read version of Lindsay Ellis quitting YouTube is really the story of a content creator who ultimately was simply not woke enough for their own audience. And before we get into the specifics of exactly what happened, I do want to say a huge thank you to today's sponsor, Glow with Lauren. A new study is highlighting some facts about our wrinkles. In the study, women would ask how their mood would change if they look younger. 31% of those women said they would feel more confident, while 15% said they would feel more like themselves. 11% of them said that they would feel more relaxed, and 9% of them said that they would be happier. Whether we like it or not, and whether it should be that way or not, for many of us, our appearance is tied to our confidence. And if you are someone who is concerned about things like wrinkles and sagging skin, then you are gonna love Glow with Lauren. This is a product I've been using for a while now, and when I started, personally, I could not believe how effective this rejuvenating serum really was. Guys, within no time, my skin felt smoother and firmer. Basically, what it does is help reduce the visible signs of aging, things like sagging skin, crow's feet, and more. It's the only anti-aging serum that I've seen such fast and huge results, and if you don't see results in as little as 7 days, you get your money back. So if you want help restoring your youthful glow, you're gonna love Glow with Lauren, and you can get it for up to 38% off for the next 24 hours by going to youngwithlauren.com or by clicking the link in the description. So the latest quote-unquote scandal that led to Lindsay Ellis quitting, and that can really only be referred to as a scandal if you're someone who runs in extremely woke circles, all began when Lindsay Ellis posted this tweet earlier this year. She wrote, "Also watched Raya and the Last Dragon, and I think we need to come up with a name for this genre that is basically Avatar the Last Airbender reduxes. It's like half of all young adult fantasy published in the last few years anyway." All right, so for most of us, that tweet probably registered as like a non-statement, just something that you read on social media and then move on with your day. But for the uber woke audience that Lindsay Ellis had cultivated, no, this tweet right here was just a giant statement of racism. Seriously, this seemingly innocuous tweet actually upset people so much online that eventually Lindsay Ellis had to delete it and then issue this, I guess, clarification. Because you see, apparently people were under the assumption that Lindsay Ellis was comparing Raya the Last Dragon, which is a Disney movie, to Avatar the Last Airbender because they're both IPs that have to do with like Asianness, and she's saying that they're the same just because they're Asian, which I personally didn't get at all from that statement. But anyway, here is what Lindsay Ellis had to say about the backlash. She wrote, "I can see where if you squint, I was implying all Asian inspired properties are the same, especially if you were already privy to those conversations where I had not seen them. But the basic framework of The Last Avatar is becoming popular in fantasy fiction outside of Asian inspired stuff." She then continued to say, "Oh, and one other thing, saying a thing thing is structurally similar to another thing is not a dig. Why do people immediately get defensive and think that it's a dig? No story is truly original. There was a lot I didn't like about Raya, but its similarity to Avatar The Last Airbender wasn't it, ya crazies. Again, for us normal people, nothing wrong with those posts. She was being attacked, being accused of racism, and she simply clarified that, no, I didn't mean to compare these two things simply because they're both Asian. I actually had reasons related to the story structure and the plot to say that Raya was similar to Avatar The Last Airbender. But see, the problem there was that Lindsay Ellis did not apologize. Lindsay Ellis did not admit that she had in fact committed a racism. And as we all know, since Lindsay Ellis is a white woman, it's actually not her place to tell POC what they should or should not be offended by or what is and is not racist. So actually, instead of calming things down, it seems like those tweets kind of exacerbated the situation to the point where Lindsay Ellis then ended up deleting her entire Twitter account. But things didn't end there because the criticism, or what Lindsay Ellis refers to as harassment. I don't know if it's fair to say that things crossed into harassment because I don't know what kind of DMs or messages she was receiving privately. But these allegations of racism clearly weighed so heavily on Ellis that she ended up making an hour and 40 minute long video called Mask Off, defending herself and basically trying to address all of the different accusations of being intolerant that she had received over the years, again, from people who kind of seemed like were in her own audience. The video is called Mask Off. You can still find it on Lindsay Ellis's YouTube channel, and it currently has around 2.6 million views at the time that I'm filming this. And in the video, not only does she address the Raya / Last Avatar controversy, she also includes like a 40-minute segment going over all of the other things she's done over the years that people have attacked her for. Specifically, last year in 2020, Lindsay Ellis put out this tweet, which again, people thought was racist. She wrote, "Someone sitting in front of me on this plane is watching the movie Harriet," which by the way is about Harriet Tubman. And she wrote, "I find myself wondering whether there is any Raylo-style fanfiction between Harriet and her Twinkie former owner, and suddenly grateful that the connection on this plane is not strong enough for me to check." And by the way, for those of you lucky souls who are not familiar with what Raylo is, it's basically a genre of like fanfiction / the Star Wars fandom where people shipped or wanted a relationship to happen between Kylo Ren and Rey from the Disney trilogy Star Wars. Yeah, it's a stupid thing, but anyway, people thought that this tweet from Ellis was insensitive because, I mean, it's essentially trying to ship a slave and her master, which is like very insensitive to the experience of being a slave. So yeah, some folks didn't like that. And one of the things that I saw people attacking Ellis for online that I actually found kind of funny was that in 2020, she did this whole Twitter thread, essentially live tweeting the voting results coming out of Atlanta, Georgia. And in that thread, she was using a lot of GIF reactions featuring, let's just say, African-Americans. And seeing as how Atlanta, Georgia is a very predominantly Black city, a lot of people thought that not only was this racially insensitive, it actually qualified as like digital blackface. Yes, it's all very tiring, isn't it? But as you could probably tell from the 40-minute segment addressing all of this stuff, that's not all Lindsay Ellis was being attacked for. I don't have time to go through every single thing. Again, if you want to watch Lindsay Ellis's video, you can do that yourself. But something else that I thought was especially strange for people to pick on her about was the fact that not long ago, Lindsay Ellis did a video essentially trying to dissect and understand why the Twilight series by Stephanie Meyer got so much hate when it did. And the really simplified version of what Lindsay Ellis was saying is that Twilight wasn't terrible, but people have a tendency to really pick on and harp on things that young girls like. And through Lindsay Ellis's intersectional lens, the reason why this isn't because the things that young people, including young girls, like tend to suck, which is my position. It's because sexism. But see, this video actually made Lindsay Ellis racist herself because in addressing the criticisms of Twilight, she failed to mention that some people didn't like that it portrayed Native American tribes and cultures in a racially insensitive way. You would think that this is like the most cuddly cat ever, but really he only comes to me when he's hungry. Okay, I'm back and it turns out Zero has food in his bowl, but he doesn't want food, he wants treats, which is like, I can't help you, buddy. We can't always give you treats. But anyway, regarding the Lindsay Ellis situation, here is what one Indigenous blogger of color has to say. This individual writes, "When Lindsay Ellis finally responded to the fact that she didn't address the anti-Native stereotypes in Twilight, It was as dismissive as you would expect. She claimed she was uncomfortable discussing the racism in Twilight because other natives liked it, but had no qualms in starting off her career tearing Pocahontas to shreds and making another monetized YouTube video about it years later. In previous videos, she is able to acknowledge problematic elements but not commenting on them further so as to not overstep any boundaries. For example, addressing the way autism is portrayed in My Name is Khan and extremely loud and incredibly close, but she couldn't do it for a Twilight video. Even a simple, there's a discussion to be had about the very problematic portrayal of the Quileute tribe, but I'm going to leave that to someone more qualified than I could have sufficed, because at least the problem was acknowledged. She claimed she didn't want her video to be longer than 20 minutes at that time. The sentence would have taken less than 10 seconds to fit into her video, even as an annotation, even as a comment in the video summary, but apparently, white teenage girls having their favorite globally successful franchise mocked and ridiculed took priority over continued anti-Indigenous racism. Yikes. It turns out people really do like criticizing Lindsay Ellis online for apparently, allegedly, being racism. And I know looking at all of those examples and all of that criticism, some of you might be inclined to sympathize with Ellis, to feel bad for her. And don't get me wrong, if people were actually harassing Ellis or threatening her, that's not okay, that's not justified, and yeah, we should feel bad that a person had to go through that. But when it simply comes to others criticizing Ellis for her takes supposedly being racist, I, for one, do not feel bad for Ellis because, quite frankly, this culture and this ideology is something that she herself has participated in for far too long. I don't mean to sound rude, but honestly, if Lindsay Ellis doesn't like people calling her racist for no good reason, maybe she should not participate in that same behavior. Never mind her entire video catalog of just calling works problematic for, I mean, really no good reason at all, which you guys can find and watch yourself if you care to. But let's look at some tweets that literally took like 2 seconds to find, displaying Lindsay Ellis doing the same things to others, i.e. calling them racism for no good reason, that she now complains is such a burden to her online career she can no longer continue it. First off, last year, Glenn Greenwald, who by the way is on the left, he is by no means on the right, he is simply, I guess, anti-woke. He tweeted out a post saying, should the populist left work with the populist right where they have common ground or shun them? Reasonable question to ask, is it worth working together when we have common ground even though we disagree on many things? To which Lindsay Ellis replied, the feeling when you are so deep in the weeds of political theory, you are completely detached from why people believe what they do. To be clear, racism is a feature, not a bug to these movements. No, you jackass, no, you cannot ally with these people because your ultimate goals are not the same. They'll push for Medicare for all only after they get their all-white ethno-state. That's right, guys. According to Lindsay Ellis, the populist right literally wants an ethno-state. And this lady has the gall to wonder why the people who follow her are such assholes. Next, in response to a tweet from Ivanka Trump stating, as we grieve over the evil mass shootings in El Paso and Dayton, let us not overlook that Chicago experienced its deadliest weekend of the year, Ellis wrote, it's weird that we live in a world where the word Chicago has become a racist dog whistle, but based on the Fox News watching family members I've unfriended, we've been there for a few years now. Yeah, apparently worrying about homicides in Chicago, which, by the way, disproportionately affect Black people, that's racist. I'm pretty sure if Ivanka Trump actually hated Black people, she would be a-okay with the way things are going in Chicago, but let's move on. Next, as some of you may remember, last year, a bunch of intellectuals and public figures got together to publish a letter in Harper's Magazine, essentially pushing back against the concept of cancel culture. This letter was signed by a lot of people, including a lot of left-wing people like Margaret Atwood, J.K. Rowling, Noam Chomsky, and Jonathan Haidt. And essentially, the letter really was just pushing back on the idea that people should be canceled for daring to ask questions or having unorthodox opinions. Here's what Lindsay Ellis had to say about that. I don't believe that all of the people who signed that Harper's letter are the flavor of rich white person who is mad they're getting dragged for bad Twitter opinions and calling that cancel culture, but enough of them were that is the message that's being elevated. Oof, that take has aged like milk, Lindsay. But if that weren't bad enough, she also continued, that's why that letter is so disingenuous. This isn't about creating an atmosphere where ideas can be exchanged and challenged freely. This is an atmosphere where these rich white people with no skin in the game can spout their BS without pushback. I don't want to say that in light of those tweets, I have somewhat a sense of schadenfreude looking at where Lindsay Ellis is now. But yeah, that did. I think it's worth noting that perhaps the way that Lindsay Ellis viewed that Harper's letter is the way that so many other people online view Lindsay Ellis's non-apology video. Simply put, if Lindsay Ellis is being consistent and really does believe that all it takes to be called a racist is for, I don't know, some POC person somewhere or online internet activist to call you a racist, then frankly, no, I cannot bring myself to feel bad for the current criticism that she is getting that has led to her quitting her YouTube career. And actually, if you are still somehow at the point where you feel bad for Lindsay Ellis, where you do not agree that she has absolutely contributed to the current controversies that she finds herself in, then let's go through the Patreon post where she essentially explains why she is quitting YouTube. If you're hoping that it will be a place for any self-reflection whatsoever into how she personally has contributed to a toxic online culture, then you will be disappointed. And by the way, this little letter thing is posted to Lindsay Ellis's Patreon account, and initially everyone could read it. You didn't need to be a Patreon, but since she posted it and it got a lot of attention, it has now been privated. But anyway, internet doesn't forget, and here are some parts that I find especially interesting. She writes, "Many will say this is being melodramatic, that my life isn't over, that there was absolutely nothing stopping me from brushing myself off, building back up goodwill, and shutting up and playing the game. And I tried that. In a way, I suppose it's good that I did, because I needed to learn the hard way that this was never going to work. There is no un-effing this. You can't find the energy if there is nothing left to convert to it. You can't be a better person if you are nothing but the hollow shell of one. 2021 has been the worst year of my life. I am traumatized by it." Here's the thing. Since Lindsay Ellis is apparently so painfully aware of how damaging being called a racist can be to not only your career, but just your mental health in general, my question is, why was she so quick to levy that same accusation against others? Like, it really doesn't make any sense. And I mean, I am sorry, and I do empathize with the fact that this is someone who has clearly had a very rough go of things. But I mean, at the same time, if they were still consciously contributing to this same nightmare happening to other people, I feel like there's only so much sympathy and empathy that I can give. And then next, Ellis continues to criticize the woke online hate mob that arguably she herself has been part of in the past, and not that long ago in the past. She says, "The worst thing about this whole thing is that I can't even admit this trauma because of all the rhetorical devices people have already come up with to dismiss it. That centering my own pain is evidence of not listening. Does it occur to these people that you can listen and disagree with other people's conclusions? That I'm weaponizing my fragile white womanhood or whatever to say that having thousands upon thousands of people who you've never met hate you and say whatever will get them the most upvotes is traumatizing." And then here in this next part, I think it really illustrates how much of a victim mentality Lindsay Ellis has. Like, I can definitely sympathize as someone who is also online with what it feels like to have a dog pile going on around you. But at the same time, I mean, let's be real here. You are an extremely successful YouTuber who still has millions and millions of fans out there. Ellis wrote, "My favorite are the people who dismiss any potential harm I might have incurred as justified because I am a wealthy white woman. I am not wealthy." Okay, Lindsay, you're a best-selling author, millions of subscribers on YouTube. She says, "While these same people's hearts positively bleed for Britney Spears." All right, I don't really want to go into the whole Britney situation, but basically Britney Spears was in a conservatorship where she legally wasn't able to act like an adult for 13 years. For 13 years, she could not make decisions about what was going on in her career, in her personal life too, to a large extent, and she did not have control over her own finances. Lindsay Ellis, that is not the same as complaining about people being mean to you on Twitter, and I say that as someone who people are frequently mean to on Twitter. And in defense of the people attacking you, who, I mean, I'm definitely no fan of either, it's not just that you are a rich white woman in this situation, it's that you are a rich white woman who is complaining about being criticized online, and you are kind of taking that to an extreme place. Again, I'm not saying that it's fun, and I'm not saying that actual harassment or like threats that might be sent your way because of this are justified, they're not. But no, that is not the same as having your agency denied for over a decade.
And here in this next part, this is where we really see Ellis throwing a pity party.
But all I know now is that being in the public eye at all is a losing game, and I regret all of it. I regret every time I've ever stood up for anyone. It always backfires. I regret every time I push back against something unjust. It was always just used to hurt me. I regret every time I showed any vulnerability, just more ammunition to be used against me later. I regret every time I ever tried to play the game with peers and colleagues. They will drop you the second you aren't popular on Twitter anymore. It's all hollow and brittle, and if there is one thing I have learned this year, it's how imminently expendable I am.
What's really shocking about this isn't that Lindsay Ellis, as a huge creator, is having a period where she's struggling with hate and criticism and therefore has had some tough mental health journeys. Like, I totally get that.
Is that in no way really throughout any of this, her video response, mask off, or this essentially resignation letter, does she accept that perhaps the reason why she feels this more harshly is specifically because of the audience that she herself has catered to?
I mean, you reap what you sow, play stupid games, win stupid prizes, live by the sword, die by the sword. I don't understand how someone as honestly, yeah, intelligent and usually thoughtful as Lindsay Ellis is not seeing this.
It is not normal for your own audience to be jumping down your throat for innocuous tweets that really harm nobody.
And the fact that you've had to deal with this, Lindsay Ellis, so many times, I would think would be cause for self-reflection, for you to ask yourself, what exactly am I doing? Where it's not just haters that are attacking me, but it's actually people from within my own audience and within my own community. They will not stop coming for me.
And to just really highlight how, even though there may be hope for redemption for Ellis in the future, we are definitely not there yet.
The good, progressive, cis, straight, wealthy white men keep on trucking and coming out on top because deep down, they know that the systems they profess to stand against ultimately exist to benefit them.
I don't even know what to say at this point, Lindsay. You've made your bed, now you gotta lie in it.
And just to be clear here, I'm not saying that Lindsay Ellis should have been chased off the internet or that I'm even happy to see her go, because I'm not.
All I'm trying to say here is that you can't cultivate a toxic atmosphere of what these people like to call accountability and then be surprised when eventually that beast comes for you.
And actually, even though a lot of supporters of Lindsay Ellis were very upset by this news, predictably, there were still some people out there who, when they saw that she was leaving YouTube, were like, yeah, good, because she's racist.
As one person said, telling Lindsay Ellis her take is racist is not being a mob.
Another person said, guess I'm just gonna say it out loud, Lindsay Ellis being harassed sucks, but Lindsay Ellis was racist in her dismissal of Indigenous people with regard to the portrayal of the Quileute tribe in the Twilight series. It is not POC's responsibility to protect white people when we call them out.
Yeah, I guess there you have it. That's pretty much all I have to say for now, and sorry if this video seemed meaner. I didn't mean for it to come across that way. It's just, yeah, frankly, creators like Lindsay Ellis who cultivate this like mob mentality of calling everyone racist, you know, it's kind of hard for me to be sad when that same attitude comes back to bite them.
In any case, if you enjoyed this video, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. It helps me out so much. Until next time.